Well, this is part of our explainer series where we pick up one issue or one story, break down all of the details and look at it from every possible angle so that you can understand that issue better. Today we're going to look at the bill that Parliament passed. It's called the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi Amendment Bill 2021. What does this bill entail and why is it such a massive issue right now? Let's take a look. Well, first of all, the bill was passed in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. In Rajya Sabha, there was a lot of ruckus. A lot of the members of opposition parties actually walked out. Finally, when the voting happened, about 83 people in Rajya Sabha voted for and 45 voted against. But like I said, most people had already walked out by then. The bill passed. Now, what does this bill actually do? The bill effectively, exponentially increases the powers of the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi and drastically reduces the power of the government of Delhi, the elected state government of Delhi. Let me take you through the provisions of the bill. And there are three provisions. First of all, it says that in any law in Delhi, wherever the word government is mentioned, government means the Lieutenant Governor. It doesn't mean the elected representative government. Secondly, it said that the government, the elected government, will have to get the LG's opinion on all matters as specified by the LG before the government takes any executive decision on the cabinet or issues on the matter of the Delhi government. The bill also bars the assembly and any of its committees from making rules to take up matters concerning the day-to-day administration, also from conducting inquiries relating to administrative decisions. Now, why is this a problem? But to understand why this is a problem, we have to take a step back into the history of Delhi. Well, as you know, Delhi was a union territory right up till 1991. But unlike other union territories, Delhi was special. Delhi was special because within the city of Delhi, it contained the seat of our national power. Parliament is there, Supreme Court is there, the homes of all of our VVIPs is inside of Delhi. The diplomatic enclave where all of the diplomats also live is inside of Delhi, which means that it required special administration, special security. So Delhi was not like other union territories, but it had a sharply higher population, which meant that there was also a need for them to have an elected representative. So in 1991, there was a bill passed in Parliament and it was called the National Capital Territory of Delhi Act. Now this bill effectively did some very simple things. It elevated Delhi from a union territory into a sort of union territory plus, let's call it, where basically, apart from being a union territory as a special case, because it was the capital of the country, it was given a special constitutional status. Now under this status, and this was actually in Article 239AA that was added to the constitution. According to this article, Delhi was allowed a fully elected assembly, a council of ministers from that assembly, and a chief minister from that council of ministers. So effectively, that's exactly how a state government functions. But along with the fact that it had an assembly and a council of ministers, it also had a lieutenant governor. Now, other state governments have just a governor. Delhi continued to have a lieutenant governor. The state government was given authority to decide matters on all things except for three things, which is land, police, and public order. Now, these three things were administered by the lieutenant governor, and the lieutenant governor was an appointee of the Home Ministry of the Government of India. So, effectively, through the LG, it was being administered by the Government of India. There was, of course, the relationship between the lieutenant governor and the elected representatives of the state government. Now, effectively, just like any governor or the president of India, the lieutenant governor also has to sign all decisions made by the state government. But it's only on those three matters, land, police, and public order, that the lieutenant governor has the ability to make decisions. Everything else, it said, he has to work on the aid and advice of the ministers. Any sort of difference of opinion had to be referred to the President of India. Now we want to look a little bit, take a second to look at the aid and advice of ministers, right? What does that mean and where did that come from? This is actually something we inherited from the British system. Now in the British system, there's the monarch, the Queen of England. the Queen of England is sort of the head of state. She's the commander of their forces. The government acts in her place, but actually, she doesn't make any decisions at all. She is to act in aid and advice of ministers. She can't make unilateral decisions or she can't start anything on her own. Now, it is exactly that system that was sort of replicated with the President of India. Now, the President of India is the Commander-in-Chief of our forces as well, and he does, and everything that is passed by Parliament goes through his office, but he is, as per the Constitution, to act in aid and advice of his ministers. Now, the LG is meant to do the same thing in Delhi for three counts, which is land, police, and order. That is how the entire thing was laid out in 1991. But as you know, after Arvind Kejriwal became chief minister, there was a lot of to and fro about the fact that the Delhi chief minister alleged that the LG was holding up his files and not signing them. And he didn't have the ability to really do the work he wanted to do because the LG didn't see eye to eye with him. It was then that this matter went to court. It first went to High Court, then it went to Supreme Court, then it was actually referred to a constitutional bench, and there was a 5-judge bench, no less, headed by the Chief Justice of India, then Deepak Mishra, who gave us an order on this matter. And it was a very clear order. It was not at all ambiguous. It basically said that the LG's concurrence, and in this case, we'll put up an explanation, concurrence means agreement. So asking for the LG's agreement on matters other than police, public order and land is actually not required. This is what the Supreme Court said. And let me quote that order. It basically said, it has to be clearly stated that requiring prior concurrence or agreement of the Lieutenant Governor would absolutely negate the ideals of a representative government and democracy conceived in the NCT Act of Delhi by Article 239AA of the Constitution. He's referring to the 1991, decision made by the Parliament. This is what the court ruled. It also said the LG is bound by the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. Now, there was more in this judgment that must be noted. It said the status of the Lieutenant Governor in Delhi is not that of a governor of the state. Rather, he remains an administrator. So he does have some administrative duties. He remains an administrator in a limited sense, working with the designation of Lieutenant Governor. So it also noted that he's not a governor who doesn't have any say. He's still an administrator. He does have the designation of Lieutenant Governor. It also pointed out that Delhi is not a full state. So what happens now that this new amendment has been passed in Parliament that effectively, like I reminded you, effectively says that everything has to go through the LG's office. Everything that has the word government in it actually means the LG, and that the state government doesn't have the ability to decide anything. What happens now? The bill forces the elected government to pass all its decisions through the LG. It makes it mandatory for the elected government to pass all of its files through the LG's office. Now, after the Supreme Court judgment that I talked about in 2018, which was seen as a massive victory for the Aam Aadmi Party government, the Supreme Court had basically said that the LG needs to be informed, but his agreement doesn't have to be sought. So the Aam Aadmi Party government was actually just informing the LG FYI about things they decided to do, but they weren't asking for his agreement. But this is where we are right now. Things will change drastically. Now, based on experts who've spoken to us on various conversations that we've had and on articles and columns that experts have written in newspapers, it does seem like, first of all, everything the Delhi government does will now have to pass through to the LG's office. Everything the Delhi government has done up till now, all decisions that have been made up till now, free rides for women in public transport, decisions on the Delhi Jal Board, decisions on electricity, free electricity being handed out, all of that could be brought into question. The LG could relook at everything all over again. It also renders the Delhi elected state government basically unable to make any decisions on its own. So accountability to the citizens of Delhi has come down now to zero. Because you don't, as a citizen, elect the Lieutenant Governor. He's an appointee of the central government. So he's not accountable to the citizens in any way. Whereas the elected government that the citizens actually vote for can do nothing. So if the citizens approach their representative in their constituency saying, I have a problem with water or electricity or whatever else, there is nothing that representative can do to actually solve your problem, without the LG's approval. So it has broken down that fundamental basis of democracy. There's also a question of the federal structure, which is a division of power between state and center. Delhi government is part state. So that division of power right now has in fact been broken down, and the center has taken all the power for itself. And that's another question that has in fact come up. Fundamentally, if you barebone look at the decision that has been made by Parliament, our Parliament has decided that the word government means an appointed individual and not the elected representatives. And this again is something that's going to draw a large democratic question over it, if that is something that actually denotes democracy or is it more autocratic. These are all questions that are currently being raised by experts. Now let's take a look at some of the responses that have come out of government. Now within the BJP, the Union Minister of State for Home, G. Kishan Reddy, the person who actually tabled this before Parliament, has given his justification, saying that this was aimed at removing technical ambiguity in the everyday administration of Delhi. This is what he said, and I quote, "This will increase administrative efficiency in Delhi. It will ensure a better relationship between the executive and the legislature. This is a technical bill. This is not a bill related to politics. There are technical ambiguities, and the Parliament has a responsibility to remove these." Now, there's been a lot of criticism as well. Let me take you through some of that criticism. Shailaja Chandra, who is the former Secretary of the Government of India and former Chief Secretary of Delhi, in a column written in the Indian Express, said, "The amendment contradicts the inherent right of the legislature to frame rules for the conduct of its own proceedings." Yamini Iyer and Partha Mukhopadhyaya of the Center of Policy Research, in an article written in the Hindustan Times before the bill was passed, said the provisions contradict the 2018 judgment of the Supreme Court, which unambiguously clarified that the Council of Ministers with the Chief Minister is the executive head of the government. They also said that by conflating the government of Delhi with the LG, the bill blurs the distinction between elected government and Delhi. Faizan Mustafa, who's a vice chancellor of the Nalsar University of Law in Hyderabad, has said this is an ill-timed move that not only negates cooperative federalism, but also upturns the fundamental principles laid down by the 5-judge bench of the Supreme Court in 2018. Fundamentally, it boils down to some very basic questions. Where does this leave the democratic right of representation of the citizens of Delhi? The 3 crore people who live in Delhi and call it their home will have no say in how their city is run, which is the basis of a democracy. Also, can we actually have in our system the word government denote an appointed individual and not an elected government at all? That's another question to ask. And thirdly, will this actually be examined by the Supreme Court that gave us the judgment in 2018 to see whether or not this is constitutional and democratic? In the meantime, one can safely assume that apart from the government assuming that this will in fact remove technical ambiguities, it's likely to bring some confusion in the day-to-day functioning of Delhi as a city, at least in the immediate future, until all of these questions are sorted out. Well, that's our explanation for now. If you have more questions on this, do leave it in the comment section and we'll try and take it up with more of our experts and answer your questions for you. If there are any other issues you'd like us to take a look at, also leave us a comment. Do share, like and subscribe to our YouTube channel and pass this video on to anyone else you feel might find the information useful. Thank you for watching.